Hi guys, Dr. J here, and in this video, we're going to talk about another descriptive statistic. We've talked about several different statistics that you can calculate for a set of numbers, and some of these are the average or mean, and let me just take a minute to distinguish between average and mean. So typically, we say that the mean is the average of the whole population of objects. So if you're measuring, let's say, the height and weight of students at Missouri S&T, the mean would be the average height and weight of every student who's at Missouri S&T. Whereas if you just took a sample of students from Missouri S&T, let's say the students in this class, and took their height and weight, that would be a sample average. And so the mean is kind of a reference to the statistics for the whole population, whereas the sample average is just a group of students which is representing the whole university and calculate their average, that would be the sample statistic. But basically the mean refers to the whole population. The average is just the whatever sample you have, it's the average of that, okay? So we've also talked about the variance, a measure of dispersion or spread in data. And also we've talked about the median as one type of what's called a robust statistic. Robust in the sense that if there are outliers in data, it's less sensitive to those. So the weighted average is still the average. It's some type of measure of the central tendency of a data set. But this, as you can imagine, this weighted means that we're somehow weighting the different measurements in different ways than we would normally think about doing. Now, what does this look like in an example? So here's an example where we have some numbers. So we have these numbers 0, 1, 1, 2, 3, 5, and 60, seven numbers, which could represent different things. And let's say, for example, for the purposes of this example, that these numbers, we're going to put them on a map, and they represent the average production in gallons per minute of a set of water wells. So in some area, people have drilled some wells, and they've produced water in those wells at different rates of gallons per minute. Let's say that we wanted to drill a new water well, and we wanted to make a prediction or an estimate for what the production at that well would be. So here is our location for our new proposed water well. What's our expected, what's the expected value, let's say, of the water production in gallons per minute at that location, given that we have all of this other information? So we know that we have this other data about these water wells. We know what those well production values are. What is the expected or the predicted water production value in gallons per minute at this new location? Now, a few things to note about this data set. Number one, it's not a symmetric data set. There's an outlier. So most of the numbers are fairly low, 0, 1, 2, and 3, and 5. This might mean that we're in an area which doesn't have very good water quality. But then we've got one well which actually has higher quality. And I can give this a little bit of context. So in Northeast Ohio, where I'm from, a lot of water wells in the area where we're from in Conneaut are sourced out of shales. So there's a shale reservoir where most water wells are drilled into. The production from a shale reservoir is not that great if you're looking for water. And so most of the well production values in gallons per minute are very low. But because it's a previously glaciated area, sometimes you'll find pockets of gravel, which may have been moraine or from a stream coming out from beneath the glacier. And so sometimes you'll find large values of water production when your water well just happens to hit one of these gravel pockets. This is kind of the geologic scenario, which leads to mostly small numbers, but then occasionally we'll get these high numbers. And of course, this is all related to the geology of the area. Now, having said that, let's come back to the question, what's the predicted or estimated production expected at this water well? Well, there's a couple ways that we could try to predict this, and actually we'll spend the whole second half of the semester talking about specifically geostatistical ways of predicting what that water well might produce. But just to think about it very simply for right now, one possible way that we could calculate, you know, our expected value is to take the average of these numbers. Now, why would we take the average? It's because this distribution of numbers represents a distribution on well production values. So we could think of this as a histogram. We could bin these numbers up, put them in a histogram, and that would represent something like a distribution of water production values from wells for this area. And so if we wanted to calculate the expected value of that distribution, that's just the average. And so if we wanted to calculate the expected production at a new well, the expected value of the distribution is just the average. And so we could use that as our predicted or expected value at this new well. Okay, so in order to define what we mean by a weighted average, let's look at how we define the unweighted average or the regular average, and then think about how we might modify it. So we have a bunch of numbers here. We have our setup. And how would we calculate our normal average? Well, the normal average is just the sum of all the values divided by the number of those values. So that's the x bar equals 1 over n. So just to explain my notation here, we have x bar, that's our average, is equal to 1 over n, where capital N is the number of measurements that we have. So in this case, n equals 7. And then it's the sum, this is the summation sign from I equals 1 to n. So in this case, I equals 1 to 7 of xi. And when I say lowercase x with a subscript I, that just means the ith value. So we have I as 1, so x1, that's just going to be the first value in our list of numbers. Okay, so this is our normal average. It's the, again, sum of all the values, the sum from I equals 1 to n of xi. So it's just taking all the xi's from 1 to 7, summing them up, and then dividing by the total number of values, which is 7 in this case. Now we can rewrite this in a way that's going to help us go on to the next step. We can say x bar is equal to this 1 over n is a constant, and so it can go into the summation sign actually. So we can write this, again, same thing, just rewriting. I equals 1 to n, whoops, make that look like an n, of 1 over n times xi. So now we have our 1 over n, everything's the same, we've just put it into the summation. And so now it's 1 over n times xi plus, and you sum all those up. So 1 over 7 times x1 plus 1 over 7 times x2 plus 1 over 7 times x3. So in this case, we can write this out as like another list where each of the 1 over n's goes with each number. So let me just write another list here, where each element in the list is that it's just 1 over n. So in this case, it's going to be 1 over 7. So we can imagine calculating our average as simply taking each value here in the top list, multiplying it by this 1 over 7 in the bottom list, and then summing those all together. So we take 0 times 1 seventh plus 1 times 1 seventh plus 1 times 1 seventh plus 2 times 1 seventh, and so on and so forth. Now, because we've written it this way, we could also actually get rid of these double ones here, and we could just have a single one and make the weight on that on 1 to be 2 sevenths, right? So 1 times 1 seventh plus 1 times 1 seventh is just 2 sevenths. So we could just say 1 and give that a weight of 2 sevenths. That would be the same thing. And now you're starting to see the concept of the weighted average, because you can imagine these are just weights that go with each one of our values in our top list. Actually, they're probabilities. It's the probability of observing this value from the distribution. There's a 1 seventh chance that if I pull a random value from this distribution, I will pick out 0, because there's 7 numbers and 0 is just one of them. So it's just 1 seventh. If we had 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 as the top and 1 sixth in each of these slots in the bottom, that would be like rolling a fair dice. So you roll a fair dice, there's a 1 sixth chance that you observe any one of the numbers from 1 to 6, right? So that would be the same thing. So we've just sort of given ourselves two lists here so that we can clearly see that each one of these numbers now, 1 seventh, acts like a weight on its corresponding value. So 1 seventh goes with each one of these values that we've observed of water well production. But now here's the great thing, is that we could change these weights if we wanted to make use of the information that we mentioned earlier, which is the spatial information, we can modify these weights to take into account that spatial information. Another example of using weighted average is where you have data that have some errors or some uncertainty associated with them. So for example, if you're have measurements of porosity from sediment cores, let's say, there might be some uncertainty associated with each measurement. So it might be, for example, 30% porosity plus or minus 2%, something like that. So if we wanted to calculate an average porosity, we could weight those measurements of porosity by their uncertainty. That's another common example where a weighted average is used. But in this particular example, we're talking about things distributed in space, and we want to somehow modify our weights to get a better estimate of our well production at this location than we would get just by using the simple average, equal weights on every value. And one very simple way to do that would be to assign the closest number, that one there. If we assign that number a value or a weight of one, and actually it would be one of these ones, we change this weight to be one, and we set all the rest to be zero, that would be a nearest neighbor algorithm. So we would say that our estimate or our prediction for that location is going to be just equal to whatever the closest well is in space. Now, notice I said we change this weight to one and make all the rest zero. In that case, the sum of all the weights would equal to one. And actually, in this case as well, you can see because we have seven values and each weight is 1/7, the sum of all the weights is equal to one. Same thing if you roll a dice, the sum of the probabilities of rolling a 1 and a 2 and a 3 all the way up to 6 add up to 1. And the reason is because we've covered all the possible options. So when we roll a dice, there's only 6 possible options. So there's a 1/6 chance of getting any one of those numbers. It's just a way of weighting all the numbers the same. So every number has an equal probability, and that results in weights of all equal to 1/7. Where the total sum over all the weights, because these weights are kind of like probabilities, is equal to one. And so if we set one of the weights equal to one, all the rest of the weights would equal zero. So that would be the nearest neighbor algorithm, setting this weight here equal to one, setting all the rest equal to zero. There's another way we could think about doing a weighted average here, and that is weighted by distance. So let's say maybe nearest neighbor is a little bit too extreme. We're just taking the closest value, but maybe there's another value. You know, this value of 60 up here is not too much farther than this value of one is here. And so maybe we want to take into account all the values that are close by. And so we could do a weighted average where the weights are somehow related to distance. So for each data point that we have, there's a distance associated from that location where that value was obtained to the location where our new value is. And we could call this distance D, or we'll say DI for the distance between our ith measurement and our new prediction location. Now, if we want to create weights, it makes sense that things that are closer together would be more similar. That's the basis for the nearest neighbor algorithm. So we would want the weights to not be related to distance, because bigger distances, we don't want those locations to be weighted higher. So we could do one over the distance. So another set of weights that we could imagine is to use one over the distance from each location. So one over D, one here being the distance between the prediction location and the first observation, which is zero, one over D2, one over D3, all the way up to one over D7, okay? So we could use one over the distances to each one of those. But remember, we need these weights to add up to be one because they're kind of like probabilities. They're the probability of getting any one of these numbers. So we need to modify these weights some way so that they all add up to one. And the easiest way of doing that is by simply taking one over the distance and then summing up all of those values, one over D1, one over D2, sum those all up and then divide each number by the total sum. So I'm going to modify this now. Instead of just having one over D, I'm going to just say W1, W2, W3, W7, where W now represents weight. So our weights WI are going to equal one over DI, and then we want to divide by So I'm going to say divide by the sum of all the weights. So I equals 1 to 7, 1 over di. I'll calculate 1 over the distance for each one of these values. I'll sum that all up, and then I'll divide each one of the individual 1 over distance values by that total sum. And that whole thing is going to be my weight. So now I've come up with a new set of weights, and this is called the inverse distance weighting scheme. You're taking a weighted average based on the inverse distance to your prediction location from all the measurements. And each one of the weights is 1 over the distance normalized by the total sum of all the 1 over distance values, inverse distance values. So this is one example where we would use a weighted average. We're kind of moving from beyond descriptive statistics in this case to something which is more about making predictions or modeling. All right, so hopefully that helps you understand this idea of a weighted average a little bit better. The weighted average is used in a number of different contexts, depending on whether you're making a prediction. Maybe in the case of porosity, you want to get a better estimate of porosity because some values might be very uncertain. So a weighted average, we're taking the equal weights of the ordinary average and modifying them to accomplish some purpose. Okay, so that's all for this video, and I will see you in the next one.